Write down next topic, size of the nucleus. See, when it was discovered that there is something like a nucleus that exists in an atom, which is extremely small, and almost entire mass of the atom is residing inside the nucleus itself, then you know, the curiosity was there to find out the dimensions of the nucleus and try to understand the physical aspects of the nucleus. So right now we are only talking about the physical aspects of the nucleus. Okay, once we have an understanding of the physical property of the physical aspect of the nucleus, we will also talk about the reaction part of it, how nucleus takes part in reactions. So that will be coming under the nuclear reactions part of it. But right now, let us first discuss about the size of the nucleus. Okay, so when Rutherford conducted this experiment, you know, Rutherford and his you know, students Geiger and Martson, they have conducted this experiment. So what they have done is they have experimentally found out that the distance of closest approach for 5.5 mega electron volt alpha particle is about 4 × 10⁻⁴ meters. Okay, this was a distance of closest approach, assuming that the only force that is there is electrostatic in nature. Are you guys understanding what I'm talking about? Last class we have found out distance of closest approach in the Rutherford experiment. Is it yes or no?
Yes, sir. Yes,
right?
Sir.
So this is what is found out. Of course, you cannot directly view at the nucleus and try to measure the size of the nucleus directly. So you have to find the size of the nucleus by doing some indirect way of the measurement. So this is one of the way in which you fire the alpha particle, you know that whatever its kinetic energy is, and try to see what is the distance of the closest approach. Okay, so that will give you a rough indication of what is the size of the nucleus. So if you increase the kinetic energy beyond 5.5 mega electron volt, what is observed is something which cannot be explained just by assuming you know, electrostatic forces alone. So there will be something called nuclear forces also that will come in the picture. All right, so that will also start influencing the behavior of alpha particle when it get reflected off from the nucleus. Okay, so several experiments were conducted, and empirically it was found out that the radius of the nucleus can be written as r is equal to r naught a to the power 1/3. Okay, where a is the atomic, write down, a is the atomic mass, and r naught is given as 1.2 × 10⁻¹⁵ meters. Okay, now r naught is the radius of which nucleus whose atomic mass is 1. So r naught is the radius of the nucleus of hydrogen atom. Fine, so the you can see that the radius of the nucleus is of the order of 10⁻⁵, whereas the radius of atom is of the order of 10⁻¹². So that is why we can say that radius of nucleus is 1000 times less in size compared to the size of the atom. Okay, so this is what the relation is with respect to radius of any nucleus of atomic number A. Now, can you find out the density of the nucleus? Okay, find out density of the nucleus of an atom whose atomic number, write down, whose atomic mass number is A. Okay, do you know what is atom mass number? Anyone? What is mass number?
Number of protons and neutrons in the nucleus.
Mass number is number of neutrons plus protons. Okay, and we know that one proton mass of that is close to 1 units, and one neutron's mass is also close to 1 unit. So the mass of the entire nucleus is like mass number multiplied by 1 units. So like that you can assume roughly. So using that, can you find out the density of the nucleus for atomic number A, and also treat the nucleus as a sphere?
Yes, sir. Is it 3/4πr₀³? So I'm not getting that.
Yeah, you need to get exact value.
Okay, sir.
Just give me 1 minute. You guys, please calculate. All right. Did you get the answer?
So 1 minute, sir. We need to calculate.
Make sure you are using SI units. Okay, so density is nothing but mass divided by volume only. Okay, so how will you calculate the mass? You'll get mass as the mass number multiplied by the mass of 1 units. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Which is 1.67 into 10⁻²⁷. This is the mass of a nucleus. Mass number multiplied by mass of 1 unit divided by volume, which is nothing but 4/3 πr³. What is r³? It will be from here r₀³ into a, isn't it? So a get cancelled off. So something amazing has happened here is that the density doesn't depend on the mass number. So density of the nucleus is independent of what mass number it is. So it doesn't depend what atom you are talking about, the density of the nucleus is fixed. This will be equal to, none of you have simplified it. ₹0.14 × r₀³. So that is 1.2³ into 10⁻².
Yes, it's around 3.2 × 10⁻¹⁷.
Yes, you are close. The actual answer is this: 2.29 × 10⁻¹⁷ kg/m³. It's a huge density. Okay, it's a tremendous amount of tremendous value it is. Now, in order to just understand how big this density of the nucleus is, can you find density of this dot? Let's say the radius of this dot is 0.01 mm. Okay, it's very, very small. Can you find out quickly what will the mass of this dot? Assume it to be a sphere of radius 0.01 mm. Just get a rough number quickly. Volume into density. Are you guys not able to calculate?
So it's approximately 900.
Approximately 900 kgs?
Yeah.
So can you get a feel of it now, how large this density is?
Yes, sir.
It's tremendous value. Okay, so just because the size of nucleus is so small, even though the density of nucleus is so high, the mass of the nucleus comes out to be very less. Otherwise, it has tremendous density. Okay, so size of the nucleus is so small that, you know, if you can just expand the size of the atom to the size of the classroom, which you have in your NPS school, the size of the nucleus proportionately will become size of one pin's tip. A pin tip, it will be the size of the nucleus will become. So it's very, very small. So this is about the size of the nucleus. Now we have discussed some of the physical aspects of the nucleus. Now we are getting into the reaction part, or some, let us say, the properties which relates to energy part of the nucleus. Okay, so the first concept with respect to that is mass energy equivalence. Okay, now what is observed is whenever you have a nucleus, I'm talking about just nucleus. Okay, whenever you have nucleus, suppose it has four protons and four neutrons. Okay, if you find out the mass of this nucleus, so let us say this is mass of the nucleus, and you find out the mass of proton separately, four times mass of a proton and four times the mass of neutron. Okay, suppose this sum is m naught n. Okay, it is always found out that the mass of the proton and the mass of neutron together, okay, their total mass is greater than the mass of the nucleus. When once they are inside the nucleus, somehow the mass of this total thing is decreasing. Okay, so there is something weird going on here. All right. In fact, if you just take one proton, okay, a single proton is unstable. A single proton is unstable. It cannot stay like this. And single neutron is also unstable. What this single neutron will do, it will convert into proton and it will give one electron with, neutrino or antineutrino with it. So it just decay down. These particles are not stable. But then amazingly, when they go inside the nucleus, they become stable. Okay, so there is something special that is happening inside the nucleus that is making it more stable. All right, I think in chemistry, you might have learned many things about forming bonds. So when two atoms, they come close to each other, the electron from one atom get attracted towards the nucleus of the other atom. So some sort of bonding happens, and we say that now there is a chemical bond between the two atoms. Okay, and when the bond is more stable, some energy is released, isn't it? Like two atoms, when they react and the product is more stable than reactants, energy will be released. Okay, similarly here also, when the proton and neutron, when they create a nucleus which is more stable, some sort of energy should be released. Okay, now when a bond gets formed, we say that it is a bond energy. Okay, we say that it is enthalpy of the bond. Okay, and when nucleus gets formed, the energy that get released is called binding energy. The energy because of which the proton and neutron, they are bounded inside the nucleus. Okay, so you can say that some sort of nuclear bonding is happening between proton, proton, neutron, neutron, or neutron, proton. Okay, but then we just like in chemistry, we went into much greater detail when we talked about the chemical bonds, right? Types of bonds are there, what are the hybridization and all that. But when we talk about the nuclear, inside the nucleus, we are not getting into too much of detail, as in the hybridization, what kind of bond they have and things like that. We'll keep it very, very simple at a high level, that when a nucleus gets formed, there is some sort of attraction, let's say nuclear force is there, that is making sure that when they are together, it is more stable. Okay, so keeping that in mind, this mass energy equivalence is conceptualized. Okay, so what happens is, when these protons and neutrons, when they come close to each other, okay, when protons and neutrons, they come close to each other, they form the nucleus, let us say four protons and four neutrons. Okay, they come close to each other and they form a nucleus which has four protons and four neutrons. Okay, part of the mass gets converted into energy. That is why the energy of this, that is why the mass of this nucleus is less than the collective mass of these constituents. Are you getting it? Now, why it is just here only? Why not in chemistry also, some part of the mass gets converted into energy in every exothermic reaction? It happens there also. There also, whenever exothermic reaction happens, part of the mass only gets converted into energy. Okay? Although you can look at it in a different way also, you can say that, you know, the products are more stable or the stronger bonds are getting formed, but end of the day, bonds are nothing but electrostatic force of attraction. Okay, so the basic thing is that whenever some sort of reaction happens where energy gets released, part of the mass gets converted into energy. Energy cannot be created just like anything. I mean, it can't be created out of nothing. Okay, so something has to get converted. So that is what is happening here. Mass is getting converted into energy. Okay, and the famous Einstein relation, which is there, which creates the equivalence between mass and the energy. So if mass M is converted into energy E, then E will be equal to M into speed of light square. Okay, so remember this, this is the mass energy equivalence. Okay, now when I say that this nucleus, let us say, has mass MN, and these four proton and four neutron have mass of collectively mass M and naught, whose mass will be more? MN naught or MN?
MN naught,
right? So the difference in mass is called a mass defect. Okay, this is called mass defect. We can also call it as delta M. So this is mass defect. More the mass defect, more is the energy that get released, and more is the mass defect, more stable the product is, because more the energy released, it means that the products are more stable. Are you getting it? So it is directly proportional to how much mass defect the reaction has. So greater mass defect automatically means that products are more stable. Okay, so although this reaction doesn't happen in nature, where four proton comes and reacts with four neutron and nucleus gets formed, but we can imagine such reaction. Like in chemistry also, we imagine different kinds of reaction, like bond energy. Whenever we are trying to find, we just imagine a reaction, and like that we deal with the enthalpies of the reactants and product. Similarly, here also we can imagine such kind of reaction and come out with how much energy will get released given what is the mass defect.